Super Talk Mississippi Media Production.
In Mississippi, with our ever-changing weather, termites and household pests can disrupt your family life and take a toll on your home. Call Family Termite and let us help protect your home. 601-933-1014. Or reach us at www.family-termite.com.
You're listening to the Rebel Report podcast, where it's all Ole Miss all the time. Here's your host, Michael Borky.
Welcome in, everybody, on this Sunday night. A bit of an atypical Sunday, because as we are talking, there is a major, like, high-profile college football game going on right now. Next week it'll be the NFL, but for now we can watch what will be the second half of this game together. Looks like LSU's about to kick the field goal to try to tie it at 10. Pretty fun game so far between LSU and USC. Quite frankly, I have as many questions after watching LSU for a half as I did going into the season. But anyway, it looks like it'll be tied at 10 at halftime. But there's a lot of college football to talk about. It is the Sunday of week one, so there's a lot of week one things to talk about. I want you guys to drive the conversation. What did you see from the weekend that you liked or that stood out to you? We'll go through the scores around the SEC and a couple of national ones as well, and then get to your comments. And then a couple of things that, you know, Lane Kiffin has actually had two press conferences since we last spoke. And so a couple of things there that stood out to me, and then we'll go through some games, and then we'll just chat for a little while on this edition of the Rebel Report. Again, my name is Michael Borky. Glad that you guys are here. Please like the video, subscribe to the channel if you have not already. And if you're watching after the fact, still leave a comment. I read them. I engage with them. So I appreciate those of you that have done that. And also don't forget to subscribe to the podcast wherever you get them. Just search Rebel Report and subscribe. And leave a rating and a review. And this edition of the Rebel Report is presented by the Gregory Law Firm. DJ Gregory and the Gregory Law Firm has got you covered for all of your personal injury, small business, or contract disputes. So if you've been personally injured, as bad as we don't want it to happen to you, that day may come. And if that day does come, you want somebody that will look at you like more than just a number to slap on a billboard. It's somebody that he'll build a relationship, or you'll build a relationship with that person. It's a more intimate legal experience for sure. DJ Gregory, the Gregory Law Firm, Saltillo, Mississippi is where he's located. But if you're here in this state, he can take care of you. 662-397-9799. 662-397-9799. Don't delay. Call DJ today. So, college football over the weekend. Running through the SEC quickly, we don't need to talk about the FCS games. Missouri beat up on Murray State. Arkansas beat up on Pine Bluff, which is possibly the worst team in the FCS. Oklahoma beat up on Temple pretty badly, but Arnold, especially on third down, not exactly like super brilliant in that game. So that was Thursday and Friday. Into Saturday in the SEC, and I'm just going to give quick takes on each one, and then I'm going to get to your comments, because that's really what I want these Sunday live streams to be, is more about you. But anyway, narratives have been affirmed about Clemson and Dabo Swinney. It is time now to adapt, or they're dead. It's really that simple with Clemson and Dabo. It's adapt or die. No. It's adapt or they're already dead. And I saw a couple of media guys, like big cultural media guys, shared this from Alan Kenny. I don't know who that is, but he said, "I'm trying to avoid getting overly bearish on future of college football, but Clemson's decline reflects where I think the sport is heading. National championships will be the domain of an even smaller handful of programs, and the sport will be less interesting because of its reorganization." That could not have possibly missed the mark more. Clemson's decline is a direct reflection on nobody but Clemson and the person coaching Clemson. Yes, he's got this moral stance that some people in my business want to pretend like is a good thing, But Nick Saban's greatest strength was adaptability. That is why he was so great. As offenses changed, his style changed, his players changed, he changed. And as a result, he won for the entire duration of his career. His adaptability is why he was so great. Dabo being stubborn and not adapting to this era at all is why Georgia beats them 34-3. And I saw some, well, maybe we're overreacting to Dabo in the portal thing because, well, Georgia's just so good. Yes, Georgia, I think, has the best roster in college football, but Clemson used to be that. Clemson used to be competitive for national championships. And no, Tom Fornelli, nobody is saying that Clemson should build their entire roster out of portal players, but there were high-quality portal players, offensive players in the transfer portal that Clemson could have been in on. It is a good program. Dabo is a good coach. There is a lot that Clemson has to offer a college football player. Big fan base. Like they've got a lot of that. And they choose not to. And instead, the offense is anemic. And that's kind of an understatement. Frankly, it's just really bad and underwhelming. And instead of filling needs with this new thing that Georgia, their opponent that smoked you, does, you do nothing and you have this moral stance. And because of that moral stance, you are completely and totally non-competitive with the best teams in college football. You used to be one of the best teams in college football. And whether it's arrogance or stubbornness or whatever is costing you. So it's really that simple with Clemson, Georgia. There's a lot to like about Georgia. I think that their offense is too east and west. Now, you know, Beck's good. They've got weapons. They've got talent everywhere. But I came away from that game thinking that Georgia's not running the table. I don't believe that Georgia's running the table this year the way people think they do. They're not going 16-0. I think that there's regular season loss in there. Hell, I think there's an opportunity, a really good throw. Miller Moss is a good player, guys. Lincoln Riley's good with quarterbacks. Looks like they might have a chance at a field goal before the half. But that's what Clemson used to be. They have made choices that have fallen them out of being there. So Georgia dominates Clemson. Alabama beats up on Western Kentucky. Really good showing in Kalen DeBoer's first game. It's Western Kentucky. Not a whole lot there. Same thing with Texas and Colorado State. Oh, I forgot to – holy crap. It's an Ole Miss podcast, and I forgot to get to the Lane Kiffin Ole Miss things from earlier. So confirmed in the press conference last night something that we kind of wondered aloud about on here, which was why Austin Simmons came out first and whether or not that was a sign that he was QB2. Turns out he won the backup job. It's really that simple. Lane Kiffin confirmed that last night. He looked like it last night. I wouldn't be surprised to see more Walker Howard just because they're going to get the opportunities to. Middle Tennessee State is not really that much better of a challenge than Furman, I don't believe. I know that Lane talked about how, you know, they hung with Missouri last year. I understand it. And yes, it's an FBS team. It's a G5 team. They will have better players than Furman, but I think it's almost marginal. I wouldn't be surprised if you had a similar score differential that you had this week. Maybe not 76-0, but I do think this could be another one of those really terrible games to watch for an outsider anyway. So that was noteworthy that it's just Austin Simmons is QB2 for this team, and he sure looked like it. And Lane also doesn't appear to be very concerned about the offensive line as of this moment. I think that it's a lot of what we talked about last night where there's a couple of guys out to begin with, and he said it was more mental than physical with the coverage bust, as well as the few issues that they had on the offensive line. It's kind of hard to criticize your team when they win the way that they do, but Kiffin overall appeared to be very satisfied, despite what the emotion that he was showing on the sidelines at the end of that game. Seemed to be very satisfied overall with his team's performance and not really all that concerned with them. So anyway, Ole Miss wins 76-0 over my Paladins. Move on, do it again next week. All good there. Notre Dame, Texas A&M, incredible environment. Notre Dame defensively is one of the better ones in all of college football. I was really impressed with Notre Dame's defense. I don't think that this is an indictment on Weigman. Let me rephrase that. I don't think this is an indictment on Elko. I do think that there's a weird situation with them at quarterback because I think Weigman's better. I think he's better than he played. It looked more of the same with Texas A&M offensively, which is not something that you should be able to say. It's game one. It's at home. It's against an elite defense. But I think that A&M's got good players, and USC misses a chip shot field goal at the half. That's brutal. I mean, that was a 30-yarder. That was terrible. Anyway, I still think A&M's going to be like an 8-win team, a 7-8 win team. Somewhere in there, and they're going to give people fits because they're talent, but not a great audition for Mike Elko there. Tennessee beats up on Chattanooga the same way that Ole Miss beat up on Furman, 69-3 the final. Not much to talk about there. Miami and Florida. The thing about that game is it wasn't coaching, and what I mean by that is I don't think that it was necessarily like Miami had better scheme than Florida, and they probably did. But from my vantage point, the huge glaring concern for Florida is Miami was better than them athletically and physically at basically every position on the field. That wasn't a scheme thing. That was a player thing. And look, it seems like this is going to go down the road of Napier getting fired regardless of what Scott Strickland said on the pregame show because if they don't get better, they're losing 8 games. It's really hard to overcome regardless of what the buyout is. But Florida has a talent acquisition issue, and I don't necessarily think it's exclusively Napier's fault. But I'm sure we'll get to more of that in the comments. It was just they got absolutely dominated in every facet of the game because Miami has better players than Florida does. And I know that there's some recruiting philosophy questions about Billy, and he said something like he got quoted saying that, you know, great people make great players. And I think it was Ari Wasserman that wrote that, no, Billy, great players make great players. There are bigger issues, in my opinion, at Florida than, well, Napier sucks. Because, oh, well, Mullen sucks. And, oh, well, Muschamp sucks. And, oh, way back in the day, Ron Zook sucks. You know, that all these coaches just magically suck when they get to Florida. Maybe it's a Florida thing more so than it is all of these coaches magically go there and suck thing. But whatever. I'm sure we'll get to that later. How about Vanderbilt? Diego Pavia for Heisman. He was awesome against Virginia Tech. Vanderbilt's not the worst team in the SEC this year. They're not finishing 16th. I think they're still pretty bad on the lines of scrimmage. They had to hold on for dear life. Probably should have lost that game after establishing a big lead. But I was really happy for Clark Lee and really happy for Vanderbilt people, as few of them as there is out there. But I was rooting for Vanderbilt. I was worried that Virginia Tech, with their garbage schedule, was going to be a bid stealer in the college football playoff, and we don't have to worry about that anymore. Thank you, Vanderbilt. But Diego Pavia is a blast to watch play football. He's tough, man. He's fun. He's just a fun football player. And Vanderbilt was the better prepared and better coached team that day, and that was a big win for them for a lot of reasons. South Carolina escapes barely from Old Dominion. And as we've talked about a lot, being a Saints fan watching Spencer Rattler, I'm certainly not the only one that has had this take. But Spencer Rattler is somebody that hid. He put South Carolina on his back the last couple of years. And the fact that those people thought that they were going to be better without him is hilarious in hindsight because Lenora Sellers has a long way to go, a long way to go if he wants to continue playing quarterback in the SEC. The offense schematically is pretty brutal. South Carolina got very, very lucky to escape Old Dominion with a win, but that's a bad South Carolina team, and I wouldn't be surprised if Shane Beamer got fired at the end of this this season with the way they looked. It's a week one overreaction, but they looked like a team that's going to lose a bunch of games this year. Mississippi State beat up on Eastern Kentucky the way they were supposed to. You know, for whatever it's worth, I have to watch all of Mississippi State's games. I get to watch them all. I really love what I do, but Mississippi State was the only team in the FBS to not score on an opening possession a season ago. So they were better, but it is Eastern Kentucky. The same context applies with Eastern Kentucky with Furman to a degree. I'm very, very concerned about their defensive line. Very concerned about their defensive line. I think a lot of people are going to push them around up front this year, but they've got some wide receivers. There's some weapons there. It's Eastern Kentucky. We'll know a lot more about them it'll strike midnight by the time the game's over on Saturday. But Arizona State beat the brakes off of a Wyoming team that won 9 games a year ago. That's going to be a really tough challenge for State. We'll learn a lot about them next week. Auburn beat up on Alabama A&M. Who cares? Kentucky and Southern Miss got called early because of weather. Kentucky was up 31-0. Southern Miss threw an interception on each of their opening possessions. We did not get really a great look at Kentucky, if we're being honest. The game was weather impacted. It was a late start, and then it got canceled early, and Southern Miss threw a pair of interceptions out of the gate. I wasn't blown away with what I saw, but I don't think that it was enough to really gauge anything at all about Kentucky. We're going to have to watch them again. As far as the rest of college football, how about Oregon struggling with Idaho? My goodness, they had to score 10 fourth quarter points to beat Idaho at home. I still really like this Oregon team, but that just kind of goes to show you how impressive what Ole Miss did on Saturday is. If you think about it, again, I know it's Furman, but just coming out and punching them in the mouth. Tennessee did the same thing. Mississippi State did the same thing because NC State didn't, and they were in a dogfight. Oregon didn't. A really talented and good Oregon team, they did not, and they were in a dogfight. And so, you know, I know these FCS games are very nondescript, or at least they should be, but it just goes to show you that when your team performs well, there is another way that it could have gone, and Oregon barely survived Idaho at home. Penn State beat up on West Virginia. That was a big, really impressive, good win for Penn State. Michigan's going to get beat by Texas. They're going to get beat by Texas. I was really unimpressed by what I was able to watch from Michigan. And that's really about it around college football. So we'll get to your comments now. I'll stop yapping and let you guys yap after I tell you the podcast is brought to you in part by Advantage Business Systems. Check them out online at absms.com. Advantage Business Systems has you covered for all of your Mississippi office technology needs. Tell them I sent you. You'll get a complimentary office technology assessment. So you just tell them what you need and what your budget is, and they will find a solution for you on me. Advantage Business Systems, absms.com. The podcast is also brought to you by Priority One Bank. Bank with me at Priority One Bank. We can maybe run into each other at a branch. But what I love about Priority One Bank is, you know, when I walk in there, they know me. They recognize me. They remember myself. They remember my son and our names. And they don't know. The people at the branch closest to my house have no idea that we're in a professional partnership together. But that's how I get treated every single time I go in, because Priority One Bank makes me their priority. Oh God, Edward, what did you do? First message, so Kiffin to Florida. Yeah, they are. The photoshops are already out there. Just laugh at it. That would be my advice to you right now. I would just laugh at it. Imagine how down bad you have to be where week one you are making photoshops of coaches that are not going to take your job. I cannot fathom being down that bad. He's not going to Florida. He doesn't want that mess. Hey, I understand that you guys are just messing around, but we're not going to seriously talk about that right now. It's September 1st. I'm not doing it. I'm not forcing you guys to listen to that. And you already know my stance on it anyway. I think Florida's the third best job in their own league, or in their own state, I mean. They're the third best job in their own state. Miami's clearly ahead of them right now. Florida State, despite losing to Georgia Tech. They are very much ahead of Florida in every discernible category. I mean, that they're Urban Meyer won at Florida because of Urban Meyer, not because of Florida. There's your take of the day. Urban Meyer won at Florida because of Urban Meyer, not because of Florida. It's if you look at the results, it's just that they're just another SEC program, and they're really struggling in this era, obviously. And then they fired Mullen, who won, 30 games in 3 years, and they shipped his ass out of town, forgive my language. So they have unrealistic expectations, and they don't have the resources to match those expectations. They want to compete with Georgia? Well, when look at what they are providing, what they're offering right now. LSU's offense has definitely taken a step back from last year. Still, Nussmeier looks talented. There's talent there. They've got some good receivers. I don't think they're going to run the ball particularly well after watching, 30 minutes of a game of theirs. But we'll see. USC's defense playing pretty decent tonight. They made a good hire at coordinator. They're flying around. This is definitely not the best defense that LSU is going to see this year. You didn't break out a sweat walking to the library. It's officially football weather in New Orleans. Oh, Rebecca, I sent some of my buddies a screenshot because we have in our 10-day forecast here two lows in the 50s coming up. Two lows in the 50s coming up. And then it's going to actually get a little bit hot next week. But still, yes, fall is here. I love it. Like and subscribe, support getting a new curtain rod. Never happening. Never going to happen. Shout out Vanderbilt winning. That can buy Clark Lee a lot of goodwill. They can beat South Carolina next. What a disaster there. They absolutely can beat South Carolina. Let's look at their schedule. Vanderbilt football schedule. They have Alcorn next, so they will be 2-0. They're going to go to Georgia State. That could be kind of tricky, but they should be 3-0 going into Missouri. They've still got Ball State on the schedule. They still have South Carolina. Hell, I mean, they still have Kentucky. I wouldn't just say there's no way in hell about Kentucky. Diego Pavia has already taken a team into Jordan-Hare and won in a team that wasn't as talented as this one. I don't think they're going to go to a bowl game, but they're going to be salty. Remember this one to tell your kids one day about, folks, undefeated Vandy. We've seen 70+0 before, but for the first time you can remember, this one felt different. Talk me off the ledge of tortures, Ole Miss fandom, please. I am really trying hard to not take too much away from a game against Furman. But yes, there was obvious depth, especially defensively. The weapons were on display with Dart and Harris and Priestcorn and on, right? But what stood out to me the most is the depth that they have on defense, especially in the front seven. Because when they put the twos and threes in physically and athletically, it did not look any different. And I know it's Furman. I understand that. But physically and athletically, the twos and the threes on the defensive line did not look any different than the ones. They've got real size and real athleticism and real depth in the front seven in ways that they have not since I've lived here and probably never have before with this amount of depth. So we'll have to see, what the ceiling is. Did they really, are these new additions the difference between being good like they were last year and great like they should be? We'll see. But no, it did physically and athletically on defense, they look different. There are so many options there. After seeing Notre Dame win, you think Ole Miss has to beat LSU. You don't think a 10-2 Ole Miss is a safe playoff team. Missouri could also walk to 11-1. Oklahoma looked shaky. I still think 10 gets you in. I do. I don't. All of these scenarios where you could have four teams go 11-1, yeah, you could, but the likelihood of that, I mean, come on, is minuscule. So I still think 10 gets you there. How long does Napier have at this rate? Until the end of the season, I think. The buyout is unbelievable, especially with revenue sharing coming. Oklahoma is going to have serious issues on the offensive line, no doubt. I mean, that flashed against Temple. Glad they swapped Vandy for South Carolina on the schedule. You know, going to Vanderbilt's not as difficult as going to Williams-Brice, but, I mean, what will Williams-Brice look like by the time Ole Miss gets there? So South Carolina, I mean, they were just awful, guys. They're going to lose to Kentucky this week. They're going to lose to this LSU team. I mean, a 2-2 South Carolina team's not but anyway. Clemson has fallen. This board is leaving them behind. They can win games in the ACC, but not nationally. Absolutely. And what's crazy about it, man, is they've chosen to fall behind. It's not like they're trying and they don't have the resources. There are programs that are trying and they can't. Wake Forest literally can't. They have the smallest school in the Power Five in terms of enrollment, like the second smallest school in all of FBS football. They don't have the people that will provide the funding to try to level the playing field for them. This era sucks for Wake Forest. It's great for Ole Miss. It sucks for Wake Forest. Clemson is choosing to not engage. It is a bizarre decision. It was always one that was going to end this way. It was always going to end this way. And people locally there at Clemson praised Dabo because it's easy in April to talk about how what a great man my coach is. And he's taking a moral stance. And how great is this? His job is not to take moral stances. His job is to win football games. This idea that, well, Georgia's got this graduation rate and at least Dabo's graduating his players. It doesn't matter. His job is not to graduate players. It's to win football games. This is not, it's not student athletes at this level. When you have a coach with a $115 million contract, playing for a school that has a $150 million budget in a conference that has multi-billion dollar television deals. It's a professional sport. It would be like an NFL team choosing never to sign a free agent. That's what that would be like. That's what Clemson's doing. And great moral stance, Dabo. That's awesome. What is it getting you? Nothing. Kirby Smart's players get arrested too much. Kirby Smart doesn't graduate enough players. Kirby Smart's players win football games. That is why he gets paid $12 million a year. That is his job to win, and he's doing it. And Ryan Day, although hasn't won championships, he's doing it. Lane Kiffin's doing it. Everybody else is doing it. Clemson's choosing to fall behind. It is a bizarre decision, and this was where it was always going to end up. Watching the defensive line take over a game was very refreshing to see. They absolutely did that. Mike, my friend, thank you so much for the super chat. I appreciate you very, very much. It is completely unnecessary, but I very much appreciate it. For the first time, I can remember 70+0 against an FCS. Oh, sorry, you doubled up your message. But thank you, though, Mike. I appreciate you, my friend. That's very, very kind. You don't know when the last time I eat. The last time I eat a starting quarterback celebrate with defensive players after a big defensive play like Dart was doing Saturday, even after he was pulled. You can see how much love that team has for him. I mean, anytime they cut to him on the sidelines, Walter Nolan's got his arm around him. It's everybody. It's not just his offensive line and his receivers. The entire team. His interactions with Lane Kiffin. Guys, rewind 2 years ago and look at the way that they talk to each other versus the way they do now. And the way they look at each other, the way they do now. I mean, he is, and Kiffin talked about it after the game. It's just he loves the individual people that are on that team. And when you, I mean, it's the beautiful thing about team sports is when you have a team that truly actually cares about and like truly likes each other, how much better they play as a result of that personal relationship. You're just willing to do so much more with people when you like them, you know, and it's very evident that this team, they really like each other, and Lane Kiffin really likes them on a personal level. It's cool to see. Cade Klubnik and the receivers are a joke. Absolutely. I mean, I think he still would have gone to Ole Miss, but Clemson could have gotten in the game on Juice Wells. You think Juice Wells could have helped them yesterday? Didn't even bother trying. Haven't been impressed with LSU's offensive line as they've been touted. USC had made key plays to stop drives, especially on the first one. Yeah, it's almost like the Heisman Trophy winning super freak of an athlete made an offensive line look better than it actually is. You know, it's Eastern Kentucky, but Blake Shapen is state's most talented quarterback since Dak. Yeah, Will Rogers, not a good enough athlete, doesn't have the arm strength that Shapen has. You know, definitely not Schrader and that group either. Nick Fitzgerald was really athletic, but I don't think he throws as well as Shapen does. But I would like to see him do it, you know, with upgraded competition. I really think Arizona State's going to really test the state team. There's a reason they're an underdog going into the game. Arizona State looked really good late Saturday night. But yeah, most talented ones since Dak, and in part because they haven't had like uber talented quarterbacks, to be frank. Like Fitzgerald was a really good athlete, struggled throwing the football. Will Rogers, not a particularly good athlete, also didn't have arm strength, in that way. We'll learn a lot about them, and we'll learn a lot about Blake Shapen. And again, I'm really concerned about what they present up front on defense. Matt Jones deserves opportunity for carries in meaningful situations. Kiffin said today that you're likely going to see that he's earned it. It's funny. I've now caught up to where you guys saw the missed chip shot field goal. The chat is cracking me up there. You think LSU needs to win this game? It's nothing but bad for Ole Miss if LSU is unbeaten. If they lose to an undefeated LSU in Tiger Stadium, they could be screwed out of the playoff. Could be. What is LSU? Okay, so they're at South Carolina. That one could get kind of dicey. UCLA really struggled with Hawaii. I don't think they're going to Baton Rouge and winning. You're not crowning Miami yet, but you were impressed. They're still good for a Mario Cristobal special at some point. Yeah, they fast, athletic, good quarterback. I mean, that just goes to show you what a difference a quality quarterback can do for a team. I mean, if Cam Ward's at Florida State beats Georgia Tech by 3 touchdowns. I mean, I truly believe that. So they upgraded at the most important position on the field, and they were fast and athletic up front on the defensive line. Tyler Barron looked good. Miami has by far looked the best in the ACC. Watching the Texas and Michigan games, Texas may beat Michigan by 3 touchdowns. I agree. South Carolina looks really bad. They do, and that's underselling it some. I think after week one, South Carolina is the worst team in the SEC. I agree. Chase Parham hit it on the head with the Jeremiah Masoli comparison for Rattler. That's a great comparison. Yeah, because my gosh, I mean, Masoli made Ole Miss look competent when they were not. It was just him. He was a hero on that team. Spencer Rattler was a hero for South Carolina. And like I've said to you guys before, the more we see Spencer Rattler play, even in preseason games in the NFL, the more we realize that he is he was special, and he carried South Carolina. And Sellers is not ready. I know it's one game. It's his first start. Throwing the football, he's not ready. Just simply not ready. More likely to be screwed if they lose to a beaten LSU team than unbeaten. Whether LSU wins or loses, this game won't change the team that they face. LSU winning just helps the strength of schedule. Yeah, no kidding. I mean, this is something I failed to mention earlier. South Carolina's only 2 touchdowns came after fumbles, like deep in Old Dominion's own territory. Plus 3 turnovers, almost lost, exactly. Kind of think Arizona State is going to beat Mississippi State now. That is who I will pick to win the game later this week, yes. I was very impressed with Arizona State, shockingly so. Especially the defense. Fast. And I know it's Wyoming, but they beat Wyoming like an FCS team, and they are not. Over 400 yards passing and 5 touchdowns, plus 1 rushing touchdown, and didn't play a single snap in the second half. Is it just me, or is that spectacular? I mean, it is. It is. It's Furman. It's an FCS opponent. But what should encourage you is just how on time and accurate with pace and touch the vertical passing game for Dart was. That regardless if you're on air, when you're throwing the football that accurately, vertically down the field the way he did with such comfort, that is a very encouraging thing, regardless of who the opponent is. Placing the ball in a bucket the way he did that deep was noteworthy. Judkins really ran all over Akron. Yeah, it's almost like I knew what I was talking about when I said that he's not just going to waltz in and take Trevion Henderson's job. But, you know, our radio audience told me that I was just being a hater or whatever. It's like, no, you guys have not watched Ohio State play, and I have, clearly, because Trevion Henderson is a hell of a back. And he looked faster. Looked faster than Judkins did. And he was more effective. And I know it's just one game. It's Akron. And look, Judkins is really, really, really good back. But what do you think Trevion Henderson would do in the Ole Miss offense? Will Logan Diggs play this year? I don't think so. If he does, it would be really, really late. If the Heisman went to the most deserving player, Travis Hunter would be number one in the odds. As it is, Dart didn't hurt his chances. Yeah, my concern with Travis Hunter is they play him too much. So as they're going to start, like, it'll start Saturday. Like, I know he works really hard, and he does all of the body recovery stuff. But when you're playing 130 snaps, are you the same player in the fourth quarter when you never come off the field, when you're playing a Big Ten team? Are you the same player? Because he has to cover everybody's best receiver, and when he's lining up at receiver, he's getting everybody's attention. And so not only is he playing 140 plays, but he is getting the most from his opponents for 140 plays, and now the competition in the athleticism is going to increase rather dramatically. North Dakota State's a great FCS team. Nebraska has a bunch of players. I mean, none. That's not true. That may not be true. But there's a reason North Dakota State's players are at North Dakota State and Nebraska's players are at Nebraska. Like, physically and athletically, it's already ramping up. Can he be the same guy playing him as much as they play him? I can't help but wonder if dialing back some would be most beneficial for Hunter in the short and long term. But yes, he's unbelievable. I mean, and not just because of what he looked like against North Dakota State. That's why, like, you can talk differently about Dart than you can Nico at Tennessee, because, like, okay, it's his first home start and it was Chattanooga. Let's see him do it against somebody else. Well, we've seen Dart do it for 2 years in the SEC already. We've seen Travis Hunter do it. He's special. He is absolutely special. Probably the best player in college football, but his team's not going to win enough games. Wiegman looked pretty bad. A&M looks like a 7-5 team. I was kind of baffled by the offense. Just it looked like Jimbo. Shout out to Iowa for scoring 40 points. That was not on your bingo card, nor them being the only 11 a.m. Big Ten team to score in the first quarter. Yeah, but they struggled. It took them a while to get going. McMillan in Arizona is your number one in your Heisman. Dude had 300 yards and 4 touchdowns. Yeah. Also, Boise State had what's his name? Sorry, I'm Googling. Is it Geanty or Geanty? G-E-A-N-T-Y. He ran for what, 270 and six touchdowns at Georgia Southern this past weekend. So there's another one for you. Good to see you, James. Glad that you are here. You say Nuss looks like he needs another year. I'm trying my hardest to watch, talk to you guys and watch both. I'm having a hard time doing it, but I know USC did some portal recruiting up front on the defensive line, but I'm with, I think it was Edward earlier that said that LSU, that this vaunted offensive line doesn't look like it so far. If LSU can get the running game going, they're going to be tough. That's the thing, can they? Logan Diggs probably won't be able to play until LSU or later. If he plays four less regular season games, he can redshirt. I mean, it was an ACL tear, right, in November of last year. That's tough. Any chance Beamer bites the dust this year? Absolutely. Absolutely. I mean, lose to Kentucky and LSU and Ole Miss and at Alabama and at Oklahoma. I mean, there's a chance that they have five losses by October 19th. And they still, after that, have to play A&M, Vanderbilt for good measure, Missouri, and Clemson, at Clemson. So, yeah, absolutely. Shout out to your doors. Thanks for the love. Hey, man, they were fun. Are the Kiffin to Florida rumors valid? There are no rumors. None. Other than people on Twitter and message boards talking about what they hope. There are absolutely no rumors. There's no validity to any of it. It is September 1st. I would encourage you to block every bit of that out. I block all of it out. Just because there's no reason to worry about it at the moment, and it is extremely unlikely to happen anyway. So... Furman could have beat Western Kentucky, you say? There's a chance. Hell, that poster right there is from a win over Western Kentucky. Now, it was when Western Kentucky played in the FCS, and it was a playoff game. But still, I'm telling you, that is a good FCS team. That's all they are, is an FCS team. But Furman is good. I wasn't bold, you know what-ing you guys when I said that they were good. It's just Ole Miss made them look like they weren't. They made them look like Pine Bluff. They're not Pine Bluff. Florida fans are convinced Lane would crawl over broken glass to get to Gainesville. Yeah, for what? For what? Less money? Less resources? NIL in shambles? Your collective getting sued? Yeah, sure. Tennessee sneaky playoff contender, watch out. I don't hate that. Schedule sets up well for them. Feel like Trey Amos is going to be a star. He looks like an NFL defensive back. You know, we talked about it a little bit last night, but he has the look. Now, got to see it against somebody not Furman, but we've kind of seen it already against elite teams because he played last year and played well. And, I mean, he looks like an NFL defensive corner for sure. For sure. Still haven't changed your 11-1 prediction? Nor should you. No reason not to. Any comment on the NCAA considering giving the players 5 years of eligibility plus a red shirt? I thought it was they were just going to do for every sport what they do for football already. I could be wrong. I need to read more about it. Frankly, I tune out anything NCAA related. Crowd was really good for Furman, too. It looked great. I saw a lot of pictures. I know that there was some weather early in the day, and it's Furman. It was really good. It was really good. Most impressive D-line play you've seen so far. I agree. Notre Dame A&M was a boring game to watch. Both teams had good defense. I think Notre Dame's is really, really good. Like championship good. You could see Ole Miss playing Georgia three times this year. That would be something, wouldn't it? Do I think we'll see any Walker, Howard in the non-con slate? Really was slightly underwhelmed with Simmons, looked a little behind. You got to remember about Austin Simmons. He skipped a year of school, and that was his first game action. So he's 18, and that was his first game action. I thought Austin Simmons, I was the opposite of underwhelmed. Because, you got to apply the context to it. He's 18, and that was his first game action. That arm is so live. It's so real. And Kiffin said that he won QB2, so I guess that he's been outperforming Howard in camp. But I do think that we will see more Walker Howard. But I was really impressed with Simmons. That arm is just so real. It is so real. It's impossible to ignore. Yes, I do think Ole Miss will set the attendance record for the Kentucky game, even though it's at 11 a.m. I do, because of how they have oversold the student section by 3,000. So, yes, I think that they will break the record on the first game because they will be able to. But anyway, thanks a lot, guys. I appreciate you. I'm going to go check out the end of this LSU-USC game. But I will post the Chris Beard interview in this feed for you tomorrow. So you'll get Chris Beard tomorrow, and then we'll be live again on Tuesday. So be on the lookout for that. Thank you guys for tuning in, and I'll see you then.
A Super Talk Mississippi Media Production.